the delegates to make fruitful use of all the BEP series. And before starting the session, we should salute our master, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, and we feel very grateful to him. As a homeopath, we should owe all our credit to him. So without him, we are nothing today. So thank you so much, master. And today as a speaker, we have Dr. G. Rajachandra. Welcome, sir. Dr. Rajachandra, he is a BHMS
MD. You're hearing on the speaker?
From Father Muller Homeopathy Medical College and Hospital, Mangaluru, and Associated Professor, Department of Practice of Medicine at Father Muller Homeopathy Medical College and Hospital. And Dr. Rajachandra have clinical experience of 10 plus years at Mangaluru Lifeline Homeopathy. And Dr. Rajachandra published many papers like Diabetic Neuropathy in Homeo Era, FAPE 2010, and 12 Tissue Remedy in All Homeopath Generals, Jan 2014, and Cancer Maker, IHK News, September 2015, a case on alopecia areata in Valerian, September 2015, and a case of lichen planus in Homeo Times, November 2015, and many more. So welcome, Professor, from IHMA, and please start the session. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, dear madam. And I sincerely thank the IHMA Kerala chapter for giving me this opportunity. And on my behalf, I welcome all the participants. So we will start this session. So as the opportunity was given to me, and I heard that it is 1 hour, I have to talk about ECG. I have selected the topic only the clinical perspective of ECG. That means today I'm just going to undermine the very important aspect of electrocardiography, that is the physiological basis. The physiological basis will help us to know much deeper about the clinical abnormalities, but because we have 1 hour time, and so I'm not going to be detailing about those aspects. So we will be talking only about the clinical aspects of electrocardiography. So first, for some time, I'll be dealing through the slides, and after that I'll be using the whiteboard, which I'm very comfortable with. And before I start the session, my apologies for the initial delay that has been created. So we will start this screen sharing. Yeah, as announced, the topic for today is a clinical perspective of electrocardiography. So yeah, I think so. You changed previous slide. Okay, so before. Actually, next slide, Olivia. Next slide. Yeah, he's Wilhelm Eethoven, the father of electrocardiography. He has been awarded a Nobel Prize also. And he is the one person who is responsible for a major diagnostic element that is available today for us. So before I go, because I think two slides are missing in the front, first I would like to thank my alma mater, my teachers, and also my patients who have helped us to know better about this particular art of science called electrocardiography. And I also thank IHMA for giving me this opportunity. So after this slide, we will go to the actual aspect of electrocardiography. Slide change. Yeah, so these are the leads. For example, when we talk about leads and electrodes, both are different aspects. What actually is connected on the human body, they are the electrodes. When we study the difference between these electrodes, for example, as you see in the picture, we see the lead one. Lead one, actually two electrodes are connected. One is on the left arm, another one is on the right arm. When we study the difference between these two electrodes, starting from right to left, the direction of the arrow is clear, right to left. When we study the difference between the electricity, that is actually called lead. Lead is not which is placed on the body. That is something which we need to remember. Electrode is what is placed on the body, but lead is something which is imaginary. Okay, so we have three leads, that is called lead one, lead two, lead three. They are called standard limb leads. Standard limb leads refers to two electrodes will be there in the body. Then we have three more electrodes connected. They are called augmented limb leads. We have AVR, which is connected on the right upper limb, AVL, which is connected on the left upper limb, and AVF is actually connected to the left lower limb. Generally, it is understood that electrodes are connected only in the right upper limb, left upper limb, and the left lower limb. We believe that none of the picture shows any electrode on the right lower limb. But when you see the nurse or a doctor who is performing the electrocardiography, they do connect one electrode to the right lower limb. You may be confused as you read theoretically, when you go practically there, what is this electrode which she is connecting to the right lower limb? That is called as an earth lead. Without that earth lead, we will not be able to take the electrocardiography. So right lower limb, whatever electrode is connected, that is called as an earth lead. Next slide. Yeah, here these are called as the chest leads. So we have V1, only chest lead, which is present on the right side. V2, V3, V4, V5, V6, all the 2 to 6 are connected on the left side. So these are the total 6 chest leads and 6 limb leads. Totally we have 12 leads which are operating to identify any abnormality inside our heart. So this electrocardiography is also called 12 lead electrocardiography. It is called 12 lead electrocardiography. But there is one more thing called 15 lead electrocardiography. If you go to European countries, the cardiologists practice with 3 more extra leads. They are called V7, V8 and V9. V7, V8 and V9, they will be placed posteriorly. So that is called 15 lead electrocardiography. So we are imagining the changes happening in the posterior wall of the heart through the anterior leads. Anterior leads not only record the anterior surface of the heart, but they also record posteriorly, but the changes will be reciprocal. Whatever we get reciprocal changes in the posterior, we imagine that, okay, some posterior changes are happening. Europeans don't want to imagine. They just want to see directly. That's why they connect 3 more extra leads posteriorly. That is called V7, V8 and V9. And I want to inform you that you will not find this in India. Okay, V7, V8, V9 is not followed in India. Okay, we go to the next one. So here, this is generally about the ECG paper. You will find small boxes. Each small box, just like our childhood, we have seen the graph paper. Each small box will be equivalent to 1 millimeter. And 5 small boxes together, when you see, there is a big box also. Okay, horizontally, when you see, when you go horizontally, it is talking about the time. When you vertically look upwards, it is talking about the magnitude or the electricity. Okay, so one small box horizontally, if you see, it is 0.04 seconds. It is 0.04 seconds. So now one big box means already 5 small boxes are there. So 0.04 into 5, that is talking about 0.2 seconds or 0.20. Okay, one big box is 0.20 seconds. So now in 1 second, how many big boxes will be there? That's very important for us as we go further. When we are calculating the rate of the heart, this calculation is very, very important. So in 1 second, you get 5 big boxes. So now if I tell you a 6 second interval, how do you identify a 6 second interval in an ECG? That means how many big boxes should be there? It's very simple. 6 seconds multiply by 5. 5, 6 are 30. So 30 big boxes when you count, that means the time interval is 6 seconds. So that's a simple calculation. Vertically, when you go upwards, I said it is a magnitude. So one small box is actually 0.1 millivolts. It is 0.1. One big box is 0.1 into 5, that is 0.5 millivolts. So when you take 1 millivolt of electricity, then the total number of big boxes it is going to cover is 2 big boxes. Because 2 big boxes means how many small boxes are there? 10 small boxes are there. That means 0.1 into 10, that is equal to 1.0. So that is 1 millivolt. So this much basics is enough. We will enter into the actual. Yeah. So here, this is a normal ECG. So when you see a normal ECG graph, you will find a P wave. You will find a QRS complex. You will also find T wave. So a normal electrocardiography graph contains 3 important wave patterns. One is P wave, QRS and T. always there is a question why he did not name them as A, B, C, D and E waves. Why he has selected P, QRS and T? The answer is simple, because of the P wave. The first wave which he has identified is a parabolic in shape. Parabola, it's a parabola. So he simply named it as P wave. And immediately he cannot go to B, C, D. So he has followed the same pattern, that is QRS and T. So there is no much discussion on that. That is what he has identified. So now coming to this, P wave, as every one of us know, P wave indicates atrial depolarization. QRS indicates ventricular depolarization and T wave talks about ventricular repolarization. Sometimes there can be a normal variant that is called U wave. U wave is not regular. Sometimes you may see, sometimes you may not see. Presence of U wave is not pathological always. U wave indicates repolarization of the papillary muscles. Repolarization of papillary muscles. So P wave for atrial depolarization. QRS for ventricular depolarization, T wave for ventricular repolarization, U specifically for papillary repolarization. But what is missing is atrial repolarization is missing. It doesn't mean that atrium is not repolarizing. It is repolarizing. But what is happening is a major ventricular event is happening. That is QRS complex is coming. So atrial repolarization goes missing. Because these electrodes will perceive a major activity. For example, you see this reporters, news reporters. For example, something is happening in the politician's house. They will be more worried about that than bothering about something happened to a poor man. Okay, so just like that here, what your the electrocardiographic leads are doing, they are perceiving a major electricity or electrical event that is happening in the ventricles. So the atrial repolarization goes missing. So we cannot find that in the ECG. Yes, next slide. Okay, previous slide. I think you also, in the previous slide, you can understand one more pattern. The P wave, normally, it should not exceed 2.5 small boxes. As I already told you, one small box is 0.04. Two small box means 0.8. Two and a half means it will go to up at least 0.10. The P wave and QRS has equal dimension. That is, both should be normally less than 2.5 small boxes. If they extend 2.5 small boxes, that is an abnormality. Kindly remember this. So P wave and QRS should have equal duration. That is 2.5 and 2.5. If you talk in terms of time, 0.10 second. Now next is PR interval. The PR interval should be less than 0.20. So I have made an equation like that. This is pure, you can copy it down. P wave is equal to QRS. That means P wave length should be equivalent to QRS length. And QRS should be less than PR interval. PR interval is 0.20. What is the meaning of 0.20? By now you already know 0.20 means one big box. PR interval should not exceed one big box. Now, coming to QT interval, QT is bigger than PR. QT interval is bigger than PR. That is two big boxes. It has two big boxes. That is 0.40. Now, the biggest interval in the ECG is RR interval. RR interval is 0.80. So now, even though I'm not telling you, your understanding, that is, it can go up to four big boxes, RR interval. When RR interval is extending, too much gap is there between the RR waves. That means the patient is having bradycardia. You understand? RR intervals are coming very closer. The patient is in a state of tachycardia. So I think that much is very clear. So P wave should take 2.5 boxes. QRS complex also can take 2.5 boxes. And PR interval should not exceed 5 small boxes. Don't confuse. All whatever I have notified there is small boxes, not the big boxes. 1 millimeter boxes, okay? PR interval should not exceed 5 small boxes or one big box. QT interval cannot exceed 10 small boxes or two big boxes. RR interval cannot exceed 20 small boxes, also called how many big boxes? 4 big boxes, okay? I think with this, we go to the next one. Yeah, so this is about calibration. One of the least interested area. I think most of you will directly jump into interpretation of the ECG, but you know that the calibration of the ECG also is important. You should see on the ECG paper, it will be mentioned speed. the normal speed of the ECG paper is 25 millimeters per second. They cannot run it faster than that. If you want to know a correct reading, the paper should run in a proper, for example, you see somebody is having a birthday, they're distributing the chocolates. If they take the chocolate box and run in front of you, what you will be able to take? Nothing. They should run, they should walk slowly so that you will be able to receive something. Here also, if ECG has to be recorded properly, the perfect and the optimum speed of the movement of the paper is 25 millimeter per second. And it should be calibrated at 1 millivolt. This I already discussed with you. 1 millivolt is normal. That means 1 millivolt electricity, if you give to the ECG machine, it will produce a wave which is of how much height? I told you 1 millivolt means 10 small boxes. That means 2 big boxes it is covering. Now, some ECGs are calibrated half. Some ECGs are calibrated double. What is the meaning? You know, sometimes because of ventricular hypertrophy, most of the time it happens, the patient produces very huge waves. Sometimes they may come out of the paper. You will not be able to record everything inside the paper. So what they do is they go for half calibration. When they go for half calibration, all the ECG waves will come within the ECG paper so that it is easy for you to read. But when you are interpreting, if the size of the wave is only five small boxes, you should add +5 because it is half calibrated. So while interpretation, we should add +5. Same problem with the double calibration. When do we need double calibration? For example, if the patient is having a very less dynamic heart or a fully dilated heart, somebody is having a severe heart block. In all these conditions, what happens is the patients will have very, very miniature waves, which is difficult for a doctor to interpret. So it is at that time where we need a double calibration so that the waves become little enlarged, or we say that magnified. Sorry for interruption. Can you take it slow? Yes, I'm sure. Yes, I will take it slow. There is a request. Can you take it slow? Surely, I will take it slow.
Go after,
so what I'm talking about is calibration here. It's a normal calibration, half calibration, and double calibration. I already told you, half calibration is required if the waves are too huge, they are crossing the boundary of the paper. Double calibration is required when your waves are too small. To magnify them, we need double calibration. Regularly, whatever the ECG which is coming in front of you, you will find it normally calibrated. These are very rare occasions. Normal calibration refers to 25 millimeter per second. The speed of the paper is 25 millimeter per second and calibration is 1.0 millivolts. That means 1 millivolt is the calibration. So next slide, please. Yeah, so this is about the axis. So very simple. What is required for axis is, this is a student method, which I hate actually. I never enjoy teaching student method, but today we have less time. Axis determination is a perfect one. Axis helps you to confirm the diagnosis most of the time. What is the meaning of axis? You know, I will put it in a simple thing here. Normally, axis means electrical axis. That means the electrical waves which are generated in the SA node, they travel downwards. When they travel downwards, they travel towards the lead two. So this is called electrical axis, the direction of movement of electricity. Now this axis sometimes can be abnormal. It can be towards the right side, that is called right axis deviation. Sometimes the electrical axis can be towards the left side, that is called left axis deviation. So that axis, when somebody say axis, it is the electrical axis, that is a vector. The direction of the vector, every vector, electrical vector has two things. One is it has a direction, it has a magnitude. That is a basic electrical physiology. So now I would like to tell you a small story. This lead one and lead two are just like a wife and husband. Just imagine they are just like a wife and husband. Now you're seeing the slide, there is written something called normal. So in lead one, okay, first number one should be husband. Okay, we'll put one is husband, two is wife. How is the direction? They both are moving in unidirection and they're moving upwards. Just see that when both are moving upwards, that means in a marriage relationship, both are going in the same direction. It is always good. That is normal. Both should be in a upright movement. Okay, that is normal always. Now you see left axis deviation, what is happening to lead one and lead two? Lead one is positive, lead two is negative. Both are going in two different directions and they are going to be separated. That is left. Left axis deviation is a divorce, a complete dissociation. So this is called left axis deviation. In right axis deviation, what is happening is when both are coming towards each other, that's right, no? Both should come towards each other. That is called right axis deviation. There is one more thing that is called extreme axis deviation. The extreme axis deviation is what, you know, when both lead one and lead two, both are directed downwards. That is a very dangerous situation because both are traveling in a steep hill down. Okay, that is dangerous one. That is called extreme axis deviation. Now, if you ask me about the angles, minus 30 to plus 104. Minus 30 to plus 104. This I am giving from the Goldberger's textbook. That is the most standard textbook. Other textbooks say minus 30 to plus 90. See, in the diagram, what I am showing also, it is representing minus 30 to plus 90. That is considered as a normal electrical axis. But Goldberger differs here. He goes up to plus 104. He goes up to plus 104. Left axis deviation is minus 30 to minus 90. If the axis is between minus 30 to minus 90, that is called left axis deviation. If it is between plus 90 to plus or minus 180, that is called right axis deviation. Now you see there is something called extreme axis deviation. That is plus 90 to plus or minus 180. That is called extreme axis deviation. Very, very rarely we get this. The clinical significance of that I'll add later. So please understand here, we can have a normal axis. We can have a left axis deviation. We can have a right axis deviation. Very, very rarely there can be even extreme axis deviation. So the right axis deviation is the lead one and lead two. Lead one is negative, lead two is positive, extremely positive. Then that is called right axis deviation. Lead one is positive, lead two is negative. Both are going away from each other. That is called left axis deviation. In normal, both will be positive. Lead one is positive, lead two is positive. Very rare in a marital relationship, both husband and wife is truly positive. So that is actually normalcy. Okay. So anyway, that is just to simplify the situation. We go to the next slide. Okay. So the step one, what is the step one in ECG is we need to identify the rate. I'm not going to detail everything here. Simple, a heart rate should be between 60 and 100. Anything rate less than 60 is bradycardia. More than 100 is called tachycardia. Tachycardia and tachyarrhythmia are both same. Sometimes physiologically we tend to use the word tachycardia, but tachyarrhythmia is a more pathological problem. Step two is identifying the rhythm. When you are identify the rhythm, these are the following things we should be careful about. That is whether P waves are present or not. Those who are writing down, one point you should write down, P wave, if it is present, it tells that the rhythm is sinus rhythm. Please remember the master of the heart is SA node. If SA node is the pacemaker, when you hold the ECG, one of the simplest question anybody can ask is, who is the pacemaker? If you want to say SA node is the pacemaker, the only one idea through which you can understand whether SA node is the pacemaker or not by identifying the P wave. If P wave is present in the ECG before the QRS complex, that means it is in sinus rhythm. If P wave is absent, please remember, it is not in sinus rhythm. What is after SA node? If SA node is considered as a principal of the heart, who is the vice principal? The vice principal is AV node. So if AV node is also called as a junction of the heart. That's why if AV node is the pacemaker, then that rhythm is called junctional rhythm. It is called junctional rhythm. Another name is there, that's called nodal rhythm. Nodal rhythm or junctional rhythm. If SA node is the pacemaker, then we call it as sinus rhythm. Only way to understand is take the ECG, identify a P wave, where it should be. It should be before the QRS complex. If it is before the QRS complex, the patient is in sinus rhythm. If the patient is not having a P wave, that means the patient is not having a functional SA node. Who has taken the responsibility? Vice principal. Who is that? That is junction. Junctional rhythm it is called. Okay. If P wave is present after the QRS complex, another big issue here. If P wave is present after the QRS complex, then the issue is another complicated. That is, it is junctional rhythm. So now AV node, just remember, SA node has responsibility of atrium as well as ventricle. Now SA node is not there. AV node is taking up the responsibility. Will it take care of only the ventricles, or it should take care of the atrium also? It will take care of atrium also. How? It will conduct the impulses to the ventricles downward, and it will conduct the impulses to the atrium upward, two directions. So this one, when the impulses are going up towards the atrium, these are called retrograde impulses. When there is retrograde impulses, what will happen, you know, first ventricles are contracting, after that atrium is contracting. That's why what will happen in the ECG, you will see first QRS complex that is followed by a P wave. So that's a dangerous situation. We can also call it junctional rhythm or nodal rhythm, or you can also call it absent sinus rhythm. Okay, any name you can give that. Are the P waves and QRS complexes regular? Is the PR interval constant? So these are the things we need to notice. Go to the next. Yeah, axis. Is there any left axis deviation or right axis deviation? That is the third thing which we need to be bothered about. And coming to the P wave, what is the shape? What is the axis of the P wave? As I told you, the P wave is the most beautiful wave. It is a parabolic wave. When you see that, it should have a perfect shape, perfect contour. That is what indicates a healthy sinus, SA node, or healthy functioning atrium. If the shape of the P is altered, it always talks some abnormality. Okay. So anyway, we'll come to that later. The P wave morphology should be examined to determine if the rhythm is sinus or from any other atrial location. Amplitude and duration should also be analyzed, determine left or right atrial enlargement. I'll show you all those things next. Okay, next is fifth one. Fifth step is QRS interval. That means the width of the QRS duration, that is very much important, because already you know that QRS means ventricular depolarization. So if there is any kind of bundle branch blocks, if there is any problem with the ventricular size, or in a ventricular tachycardia, okay, pre-excitation pacing. Pre-excitation means sometimes ventricles will start getting activated very early. You must have heard about something called WPW syndrome, okay, Lowen-Levine syndrome. So all these syndromes, there is something called as a pre-excitation phenomena. We'll come to that also, okay. One more is ST segment. ST segment is a very, very crucial area. In emergency setup, this ST segment plays a very important role, because ST segment, most of the time it is normal, but it can be elevated or depressed, particularly in relation to myocardial diseases, particularly ischemia, IHD. A patient with IHD can progress to myocardial infarction. With myocardial infarction, ST elevation or ST depression can happen, whether the T waves are inverted or not. Sometimes, you know, ST elevation or depression may not be happening. Just a T wave inversion also could be a sign of myocardial infarction. So abnormalities of the ST segment or T wave may represent myocardial ischemia or infarction. Going to the next one, please. Yeah, step 7, PR interval. This PR interval, that this is what I was talking about, Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome. What happens, you know, here, the PR interval is going to be extremely shortened. Even Lowen-Gannon syndrome, here also the PR interval is going to be shortened. But there is a small difference between these two syndromes, we will see. Long PR intervals actually talk about blocks, AV nodal blocks, junctional blocks, or heart blocks. I think we are all very familiar, starting from physiology itself, to call them as heart blocks. First degree, second degree, third degree. Okay, all these heart blocks. In heart blocks, PR interval will be prolonged. That's the only thing. Okay, last one is QT interval. What is QT interval? Okay, it looks nice when you say QT. Okay, QT interval talks mostly about the calcium related disorder, hypocalcemia, which can be sometimes grave postoperatively, and also in malignant individuals. So this QT interval helps you to understand the any imminent danger is there with these patients. Going to the next part. Yeah, I think I'll stop here, the screen sharing. I'll come to the board here. Yeah, so as you see, dear friends, here I have made a small heart. Here, this is the area of the SA node, this is the AV node, and here we have the bundle of His, here we have the right bundle branch and the left bundle branch. All the information, SA node, when there is electrical conduction which takes place from the SA node, the information comes to the AV node. By that time, what is happening? The atria are already depolarizing. That means you get a P wave. When the information comes to the AV node, what happens, you know, here the electricity takes a halt. Generally, within the AV node, the electricity stays for 0.1 seconds. When it stays in 0.1 second, when it stays here, that's why this is an isoelectric line. It is not fluctuating up or down because it is staying there for 0.1 second. Now, after it leaves the AV node, this is called bundle of Hiss. What is this bundle of Hiss? You know, this bundle of Hiss is a fast network system. For example, we talk about Japanese train, which is very, very fast. That's why what happens is, when the electricity leaves the AV node, see what happens to the waves? The waves are not beautiful like the P wave. They're very, very fast because this conduction system is a very quick conduction system. That's why you get this spike waves. This is a parabolic wave. These are spike waves. And this is a segment. When we talk about this segment, this is an isoelectric segment. Coming to the T wave is actually talking about ventricular repolarization. And sometimes, normally itself, we can have a U wave. The U wave is exclusively the Purkinje fiber or papillary muscle repolarization. Now you see that all these are the intervals, PR interval, QT interval, RR interval, but this ST is a segment. ST is a segment. So this ST segment is another interesting area. And one more thing what you need to remember here is this point. This point. This point is called J point. J point. J point is the first point on the ST segment. And this J point sometime can be abnormal. This J point is elevated. For example, if it reaches here, if it reaches here, okay, that means what happens? There is a ST segment elevation. If the J point reaches here, that means there is a ST segment depression happening here. So that's about it. And now we will go directly to the P wave abnormalities. We will go to the P wave abnormality. The P wave, what we see generally is like this, okay? Sometimes the P wave can also become broad and bifid. The P wave can become broad and bifid with a notch here. There is a notch here. So this broad and bifid P wave is called as P mitral. This is called P mitral. A broad and bifid P wave is called as P mitral. Similarly, a narrow, tall P wave is called as P pulmonale. So there are two P wave abnormalities. One is P mitral, another one is P pulmonale. What is P mitral? P mitral talks about left atrial enlargement. P mitral informs you about left atrial enlargement. P pulmonale talks about right atrial enlargement. There are only two abnormalities here. One is P mitral, another one is P pulmonale. P mitral is talking about left atrial enlargement. P pulmonale is talking about right atrial enlargement. There is also one more type of P wave, that is, what do you see? There is a positive component, there is a negative component. This is called biphasic. This is called biphasic P wave. This is called biphasic P wave. Here we have two elements here. Normally in V1, a biphasic P wave is normal. It is not an abnormality. But if this biphasic P wave happens in 1, 2, and 3, lead 1, 2, and 3, then it is abnormal. In V1, it is normal. A biphasic P wave is normal. Now, in case, if you are getting this biphasic P wave in lead 1, 2, or 3, what does it indicate? You know, a positive wave indicates left atrial enlargement, and a negative wave indicates the right atrial component. Now, I will just present to you two abnormal waves here. See this? The positive component is bigger, the negative component is small. That means both the atrium is involved, but which atrium is maximum involved? The left atrium is maximum involved. Another wave I'll present to you This is another biphasic pattern. What do you see here? The positive component is smaller, but the negative component is huge. This talks about right atrial enlargement predominantly. So, dear friends, I want to say P wave is a beautiful contoured wave. If there is a notch in the P wave, it talks about P mitral. If the P wave doesn't have a notch, lost its parabola, but it is tall, crossing more than two small boxes, it is called P pulmonale. It talks individually about right atrial enlargement. Biphasic P waves are very normal if it is in V1. If they are present in 1, 2, and 3, they are abnormal. And there can be two patterns. The first positive indicates left. The second negative component indicates the right. I think that's more than enough about the P wave. Let us go to the QRS complex. Okay, this is the ventricle, and normally this particular ventricle depolarizes like this. The first component of the ventricle to undergo depolarization is the septum. Septum undergoes depolarization first. The second component which is undergoing depolarization is the major ventricular, that is the left ventricle as well as the right ventricular bundle here. This is the major ventricular, and the final component is basiventricular depolarization. So now, dear friends, let us see. Here we have lead. What is that? V1, V2, V3. What is the meaning of V1? You know that we are calling chest leads as V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. Chest leads can be called as C1, C2, C3, C4, C5, C6. Why they are using V? You know, they are called voltage leads. They are called voltage leads. That's why they are called V. So now let us study what is happening in V6. When you have the first depolarization, that is called septal depolarization. When there is a septal depolarization, the septum is depolarizing towards V1. It is the depolarization vector is directed towards V1. So what happens in V1? In V1, you will get first a positive wave. Remember, why there is a positive wave in V1? The V1, when you see, always there will be a first positive wave. After P wave, there will be a first positive wave, which is called R. It is represented by R. But the same thing, same phenomena, when you see from V6 perspective, in V6, you will get a small negative wave. Why V6 is feeling negative? It is just like a chocolate. Two children are here. Now the chocolate is going towards V1. V1 is happy. At the same time, V6 is not happy because the chocolate is going away from him. So here, there is negative. Same thing, because the vector is directed towards V1. Here, there is positivity. The vector is going away from V6. Here, there is a negativity. But now you see this. I think V6 is there. So we'll draw a little like this. Okay, this is the correct one, actually. Okay, it's like this. Now, the second depolarization of the ventricle is the major ventricular depolarization. So here, what is happening? This is directed towards V6, but it's going away from V1. So what will happen, you know, here? Immediately the next wave is a big positive wave. The next wave is a big positive wave. But what is happening here? It is going away. So here it will be a big negative wave. So this is the standard pattern. So there is R, there is followed by S. Here first will be Q followed by R. QR. This is the normal physiology. When you talk about QRS complex, in V1, there will be RS pattern. In V6, there will be QR pattern. Now, let us go to the abnormality. If a person is suffering with ventricular hypertrophy, just imagine this is in V1. Let us draw in V1. Let us see what is happening in V6. Whenever there is a ventricular hypertrophy, let us talk about right ventricular hypertrophy. In right ventricular hypertrophy, the R in V1 will be very, very tall. The R in V1 will be very, very tall. The same thing in V2 also, it will be very tall. Okay, so in right ventricular hypertrophy, how do we diagnose right ventricular hypertrophy? That is tall R waves in V1 and V2. That's more than sufficient. That's concluded. If you find tall R waves in V1 and V2, how should be the R wave in V1? A small miniature R wave. But what is happening here? A tall R wave is seen in V1 and V2. That means you have already diagnosed that it is a right ventricular hypertrophy. Now, let us talk about left ventricular hypertrophy. What will be the situation in left ventricular hypertrophy? In left ventricular hypertrophy, what happens, you know, here there is a normal small R wave, but followed by a deep S wave. Followed by a deep S wave. This is important here. Deep S wave. At the same way, when you look at V6, there is a very tall, huge R wave followed by a small. So this is called S in V1, R in V5 or V6. Anyone? S in V1 or R in V5 or V6. Now you know you have the small boxes. Now the crown should be greater than or equal to 35. This is the criteria. As you count, you know, small boxes, for example, here you are counting, you got it 25 small boxes. Now here R wave you are counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, here you got 24. So 25 plus 24 is 49. 49 is bigger than 35. That means you are seeing a case of left ventricular hypertrophy. Dear friends, right ventricular hypertrophy, just presence of two tall R waves in V1 and V2 is enough. But left ventricular hypertrophy is more substantiated. That is S in V1, R in V5 or V6. Don't take V5 and V6 together. If you are taking V5, stick to V5. Now, how to select V5 or V6? Whichever is tallest, you select that one. If V5 is taller than V6, take that one. If V6 is taller than V5, select that. So that's the criteria here. So left ventricular hypertrophy can be easily diagnosed by calculating this S in V1, R in V5 or V6. Totally, when you count the small boxes, it should be greater than or equal to 35. Right ventricular hypertrophy is seen with patients with pulmonary hypertension, patients with tricuspid stenosis. Left ventricular hypertrophy, so many causes are there. Just a systemic hypertension is sufficient. A patient suffering with systemic hypertension, patient with aortic stenosis, patients with coarctation of aorta, patients with severe hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. There are so many causes for all these things. Can be simply diagnosed, or you can get a clue just by seeing the ECG if there is a left ventricular hypertrophy. I think now we move to the ST segment. Normally, ST will be like this. Remember, this point where I stopped right now, what happened is, the atrial depolarization, the ventricular depolarization finished here and the ventricular repolarization is starting. Okay, I'm talking about this point. This point is called as a J point. This point is called as a J point. Observe the J point in the continuation of the ECG. Now what I'm writing here, again I put one P wave, Q, R, just look at this baseline. The baseline is here. What happened to the J point? J point is supposed to be here. Now it is here. What happened to the J point? J point has gone up. When the J point has gone up, here we call it as ST elevation. This is called ST elevation. Now I will draw another ECG here down. See what is happening here. This is the baseline. What is the baseline? You know, PR interval is the baseline for us. This baseline. Now, what happened to the ST? ST came here. Instead of here, the ST has been falling down. Here, the ST is in upward. This is called ST depression. This is called ST depression. Now, the most important thing, it is not that you need to identify ST elevation and ST depression. Both ST elevation and ST depression indicate ischemia. Both ST elevation and ST depression indicate ischemia. Is it only ischemia? No, infarction also. Now, this ischemia is what? This ischemia is what? ST elevation means what? ST depression means what? For that, I will draw another picture to help you. I'll not erase this out here. So when you look at the myocardium, for example, this is a piece of myocardium. Okay, this is a piece of myocardium. Now, the myocardium can undergo necrosis two ways. For example, if you see here, this is a myocardial infarction. This is another piece of myocardial infarction. What is happening to this piece of myocardial infarction? Throughout the full thickness of the myocardium is undergoing infarction. This is called, I will write it here only, this is called transmural infarction. This is called transmural infarction. When you know that it is transmural infarction, that means full thickness is getting involved. Here you get ST elevation. When there is a transmural infarction, you get ST elevation. Now here, this infarction is not full thickness. There is some part of the myocardium which is healthy still. This is called subendocardial infarction. Okay, here is the endocardium. No, there is a layer that is called endocardium. Just under the endocardium, some area is getting infarcted. This is called subendocardial infarction. Whenever you have subendocardial infarction, what do you get here? ST depression, which is dangerous, dear friends. Which is dangerous? This is very dangerous. So a patient who have ST elevation, don't walk with him, run with him to the emergency, because ST elevation always indicates a danger. Always indicates a danger. So ST elevation is talking about transmural infarction. ST depression is talking about a subendocardial infarction. I'm sorry, just to make you understand, I said that both infarctions are dangerous. Both infarctions, we need to rush to the hospital. We cannot take any, we cannot be lighter with them. So both are dangerous. But what I'm trying to say, the gravity between both the things, this is more and more dangerous. These patients rarely survive, and these patients will come with a lot of complications after the patient recovers. Okay. So this is about ST segment. You know, another condition where the ST segment is elevated. ST segment can be elevated in the absence of infarction also. ST segment can be elevated in the absence of myocardial infarction. That is, pericarditis. I will be showing you ECGs. There you will be able to understand it better. So in case of pericarditis, ST elevation can be there. Okay. Or STT changes can happen. So that only thing that you need to remember is always ST elevation is not myocardial infarction. Myocardial infarction, what can happen? Even the enzymes are going to be elevated. Same thing in case of myocarditis, enzymes are going to be elevated, but STT changes won't be there. Similarly here, STT changes are not only related to myocardial infarction, they can happen with pericarditis also. The only difference is, I will draw and show you. Can you find the difference? Here also ST is elevated. Anybody? I think, okay. I feel as if I'm in the classroom. In both these situations, ST segment is elevated. But you see this one, this is convex elevation. Here it is concave elevation. Here it is a convex elevation. Here it is a concave elevation. Convex elevation is MI. Concave elevation is pericarditis. Okay, I think that's a very important exam question also. So convex elevation will be in MI and concave elevation will be in pericarditis. And one more thing, this ST segment elevation is not going to be seen on all the leads, only specific leads, but in pericarditis, it will be diffuse. Diffuse ST elevation. You take any lead, all the leads will be showing ST elevation. I think here I stop the board. I will show you the ECGs with which you can understand further. Next slide. So this is what we have been doing now. Rate, rhythm, axis, all those things we have calculated. Yeah. So this is where I stopped last time. So rate calculation. What is important here is RR interval. Dear friends, I just want you to concentrate here. We have two R waves over there. R waves. Sebu, can you point that R waves? Okay. Just take this. Okay. Fine. The two tall towers, what you see there, those R waves. Between that, how many big boxes are there? Can you just see here? Okay. Can you see that number of big boxes? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six boxes are there. Six big boxes are there. So now, what is the simple thing here is, you just have to divide 300 by number of big boxes. 300 divided by number of big boxes. So now, we have 300. The number of big boxes is 6. Okay. 300 divided by 6, it is 50. The answer is 50. In the second, we have 5 big boxes. In the second, we have between the RR intervals, we have 5 big boxes. So 300 by 5, the answer is 60. 60 is the heart rate. Now, in the third layer, we have RR intervals are separated by 4 big boxes. So the answer is 75. In the fourth column, we have RR intervals separated by 3 big boxes. So the answer is 300 by 3, that is 100. And in the last segment, we have RR intervals are separated by 2 big boxes. So 300 by 2, the heart rate is 150. So this is the simplest one. But sometimes you may get a situation where the RR intervals are not uniform. So where the patient is not having rhythmic nature. That means RR intervals not always uniformly separated. In such case, what you need to do, I have already told you how to calculate a 6-second interval in ECG. How many big boxes will become 6-segment ECG? 6-second interval, that is 30 big boxes. So you have to count 30 big boxes. Are you getting my point? 30 big boxes you need to count. And in that 30 big boxes, how many R waves are there we need to take? How many R waves are there? For example, in that 30 big boxes, we found 6 R waves. So what is the answer, 6 into 10. 6 into 10, the answer is 60. For example, if you find 5 R waves in that 30 big boxes, you found 5 R waves. 5 into 10, answer is 50. So that method we will use only when a patient is having arrhythmia. That means the rhythm is not normal. Sebu, we can go to the next one. Yeah, so here we have a slide for you.
And you all can see and you can identify the rate and rhythm. What is the rate and rhythm here? So now, what you're going to see, for example, lead one only you see. You see in the lead one, how many big boxes are there between the RR waves. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So 300 by 6, the answer is? 300 by 6, the answer is? It is? Okay, it is 60. So here, okay, the answer is 50. 300 by 6, the answer is 50. So here, in this, one more very important thing that you are able to see here is bundle branch blocks. The bundle branch block. So here, what is happening in B1?
Dear Dr. Surit, the voice is very feeble now.
No problem. I'll try to send. Okay.
Voice is very low.
Sir, but that Zoom setting you have to change for optimizing the slide. Just is it because of this?
Okay. All right. Sorry, I was thinking that whether you are able to see or not. Because of that, I had a small confusion. So anyway, what we are actually seeing here is 300 by 6. The answer is 50. But in this slide, you also can see one more abnormality that is called a right bundle branch block. We are able to see something called a right bundle branch block. A right bundle branch
Excuse
block.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, your like video is not seen.
All of you can follow.
Sir, your video is not seen, and voice is. I think always somewhat reduced.
No, now I am sharing the slide.
Okay, slide is clear.
Just a minute, sir. We are. I think I will come and sit there here after I don't want to.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir, but video is not seen.
Okay.
But the video icon is there.
Okay. So here video is not coming, this video. Now I came out of the border, I came to the
Okay, sir. No problem. No problem.
Yeah. Can you see my video now in front of the?
Yes, sir. Yes. Now fine, sir. Now it's clear.
Yeah, yeah. Now I'll explain from the laptop only directly.
Yes, sir. Yes. Sir.
Yeah, yeah. So, dear friends, I'm very sorry for the small changeover. Okay. So now what we are actually seeing here is a small ECG segment. Now I want you all. Can you see the cursor movement? Cursor movement. The V1, what I am trying to highlight here. If you see here, the V1, what exactly happening here is, in the V1, we have a small R wave. We have a small R wave that is followed by an S wave. That is followed by an S wave. And again, the S wave is followed by another R wave. So here, there are two R waves. This is called R. This is called S. This second R wave is called R prime. The second R wave is actually called R prime. So this is called RSR pattern. Now, first of all, how we got a doubt that there is a bundle branch block in this? First of all, if you see this, the QRS interval, as we have already learned the basics, the QRS interval should not be crossing more than 2.5 boxes. So here, what actually happened is the QRS interval has crossed the 2.5. It is almost like 5 small boxes here. So when the QRS interval is increased, that means it is indicating that the patient is having a bundle branch block. Which bundle branch block, how to decide? V1 is a very important lead where we can understand which bundle branch block is happening. So if you have, instead of a normal R, if you have an R followed by S, followed by another R wave, here double R pattern is there. This is called RSR pattern. This RSR pattern will indicate that the patient is having a bundle branch block. Which bundle branch block? That is right bundle branch block. Another important situation here is, if the patient is having no R wave at all, if the patient doesn't have any R wave is absolutely absent, then we can understand that it is left bundle branch block. All right. Can I get a small review here? You are able to listen or not? Okay, so this particular thing, so if you have R and another R, the two R's are having separated by one small S wave, that is called right bundle branch block. Now, if you don't have an R in the lead V1, if you don't have R wave at all, absolute absence of R wave in the lead V1, it indicates that the patient is having left bundle branch block. That is the simplest way to understand this bundle branch block. The first idea is the QRS complex should be wider. The QRS complex should be wider. The second important thing is not only the QRS complex is wider, but there is a pattern also that we need to. Yes, that is called W pattern and M pattern. Somebody was writing there. It is called W pattern and M pattern. W pattern and, okay, they are asking what is W pattern and M pattern. Surely I'll tell you as the class goes on. Yeah. Okay, this is the next ECG that we are seeing here. Kindly see this. There are two abnormalities here. First, we have a case here, a case of chest pain. A case of chest pain, sudden onset with nausea and vomiting. Okay, one thing that we need to understand is a patient who is coming with chest pain and also a patient who is coming with nausea and vomiting simultaneously, most probably we should understand that there could be MI. There is a dictum which we follow that every chest pain is myocardial infarction. Every chest pain is myocardial infarction unless proved otherwise. That means a doctor should consider every chest pain seriously until unless we have proved it otherwise. Okay, so that's the dictum we follow. And here, if a patient comes with chest pain and if he's having nausea and vomiting, then for sure we should evaluate him carefully. But one thing here is rate, rhythm and segment also we should understand here. See here, it is a rhythmic ECG. That means RR intervals are equally separated. 1, 2, 3, 4. I think 4 to 5. Okay. If you understand 4 to 5 here, the heart rate will be 60 or 50 in between. But one more very important thing here is ST segment. What is happening to the ST segment? See in lead two. See in lead two. In lead two, there is an ST segment elevation. In lead three, there is an ST segment elevation. And AVF, again, we find ST segment elevation. So there is a pattern here. 2, 3 AVF. 2, 3 AVF, we are seeing ST segment elevation. That's more than sufficient for us to conclude that this is a myocardial infarction happening in the inferior wall of the myocardium. The inferior wall of the myocardium is undergoing severe ischemic necrosis. Okay, so let us see what's happening here. So it is a ST segment elevation. Consider inferior injury or acute infarct. There is a junctional rhythm, no P waves found. Yes, please. See here, directly QRS complexes are coming up. There is no P wave. As we said that P wave is very, very important before we actually identify the abnormality. Whether the rhythm is sinus rhythm or junctional rhythm, we only understand by the presence of P wave is present or absent. Since P wave is absent, the ECG is identified as junctional rhythm. Okay, and the heart rate is 60 as the separation is by 5 columns. So here it is, ST segment elevation in inferior leads, junctional rhythm, no P. So the third ECG that I'm presenting to you. So here we have the separation is 1, 2, 3, 4. 4, 300 by 4. What is the answer? So probably 75 is the heart rate. And rhythm is rhythmic ECG. It is rhythmic. And now here the indication for us is, it is telling us to look at the QRS complexes. Again, the QRS complexes are becoming wider. See here, this much wide QRS complex is not possible. See, QRS complex is starting here and it is ending here. Here only 2 boxes are there, 3, 4. 4 small boxes it is taking. That's why this QRS complex is becoming wider. When QRS complex is becoming wider, what do we understand? It is a bundle branch block. What bundle branch block? R wave is there here. In V1, R wave is there. Yes, a big R wave is there. That means it cannot be left bundle branch. It is right bundle branch. Let us see here what, yeah, it is a right bundle branch. And another thing, as we already told about axis, see here, this is positive. It is going, this is also positive going upward. Both are going upwards. It is a normal axis. Absolutely. Another one. Now, first we'll start with rate here. Here, the separation is 3 boxes, 3 big boxes, 300 by 3. It's almost 100 is the heart rate. And now coming to rhythm, rhythm also is regular. Here 3 boxes, 3 boxes, 3 boxes, 3, 3, 3. Everywhere it is rhythmic. Okay, it is rhythmic and the rate is 100. Now let us talk about the axis. Here it is extremely positive. Here you see positive R is more positive or S is more negative? S is more negative. So here one is going upwards, another one is going downwards. So this is called a pattern called as a left axis deviation. What you are seeing here is a left axis deviation. All right. Another abnormality here is, please look at the P. One indication is there. Please look at the P. Where we can find out the P? The best area to look at the P. Wow. Here it's beautiful. Can you see this? This P, any difference you can notice here? There is a notch. Can you see the notch? Just above the P wave, there is a notch. When there is a notch above the P wave, what is your understanding? That is called P mitral. P mitral will tell that it is left atrial enlargement. Anything else? Next indication. Please see the QRS morphology. Wow. Another big problem here. QRS is again, it is wide. When the QRS is wide, what is the pattern you have? You have R, another R. So this is called R, S, R pattern in the V1. So if R waves are there and the QRS is wider, then we have only one pathology, that is right bundle branch block. So we have three abnormalities here. Not abnormalities. We have found that it is, yes, see here, it is a left axis deviation, left atrial enlargement, and also right bundle branch block is there. So three things you have identified. So I'm going to the next one. Yeah, it is right bundle branch block, no doubt. Okay, now this is something interesting that you all need to see here. QRS complexes are again wider. Please see that QRS complexes are again wider. Can you find an R wave in V1? This is a V1 which I am showing you. Can you find an R wave? Can you find an R wave? Directly it is dipping down and then going. And this is T. So do you find R wave? We don't have R wave. When we don't have R wave, QRS complex is becoming wider and you don't have an R wave. What is it? It is a left bundle branch block. No doubt about this. And see here, what is happening? Here it is positive. Here it is negative. They are going away. So this is called left axis deviation. We have two things here. One is left axis deviation. Another one, we have left bundle branch block. Another important thing here in lead two, don't forget this lead two here. P wave, you have to look at the P wave in lead two. What is the beauty of this P wave? Anybody? I'm waiting in the chat box. I'll be very happy if somebody identifies. Yeah, atrial abnormality. Which atrial abnormality in P wave? See, it is tall P wave. It is very tall P wave here. So that is a right atrial enlargement. That's correct. Okay, so let's go here. So here we have left axis deviation, incomplete left bundle branch, no problem. This is a left bundle branch block. And there is a supraventricular tachycardia because you see the rate here. The rate is just two boxes. That means it is above 150. Above 150, it is tachyarrhythmia. No doubt about that, it is tachyarrhythmia. Above 100 only, we call it as tachyarrhythmia. If you want to note down, please note down. Above 250, we call it as flutters. Above 250 and less than 350, they are called flutters. And above 350, we call them as fibrillation. Okay? The only difference between fibrillation and flutter is rate. Rate above 250 is called flutter. Above 350, it's called fibrillation. This is left bundle branch block. Yeah, this is a pattern that you need to remember. These are the friends. Okay. Out of these leads, please remember, let us start with one. Okay. Lead one, AVL, V5, V6. They are colored together. If you have a pen and paper, please note this down. That is one, AVL, V5 and V6. They are talking about lateral wall of the heart. Lateral wall of the heart. One, AVL, V5 and V6. They are talking about lateral wall of the heart. Now, coming to the inferior wall, that is 2, 3 AVF. 2, 3 AVF. 2, 3 AVF are talking about inferior wall of the heart. One, AVL, V5, V6, lateral wall. 2, 3 AVF talking about the inferior wall. V1 and V2, they are talking about the septum. Any changes happening in V1 and V2, we think that it is coming from the septum. Okay, then we have V3 and V4, they are talking about the anterior wall. Just remember, these are like the messengers. These are like the messengers. Okay. Now we have some spies in first year BHMS. We have some spies from second year BHMS. Okay. You know that the spy from first year BHMS is coming to you, your department, that you know that something is happening in the first year, not in the final year. Just like that, these leads will inform about a particular area in the heart. Lead 2-3 AVF, if there is any change, it is talking about the inferior wall of the myocardium. 1 AVL, V5 and V6 talking about lateral wall. V1 and V2 talking about the septum. V3 and V4 talking about the anterior wall. And AVR is talking exclusively about the right ventricle. Okay. But anyway, we don't consider because it is a single lead. It is a single lead talking about that. So we just ignore. And you know, if any of these things, for example, let us talk about inferior messengers coming from 2-3 AVF. Only lead 3 is showing some changes. Don't believe that. If all 3 are showing the information, then only you have to trust. Let's go. And this is a question for you right now. I am talking about only ST segment here. Just concentrate on this ST segment. Where is the ST segment elevated? You know the friends clearly. Okay. You know those friends. I am looking at the chat box right now. Posterior wall. Somebody has put posterior wall. Okay. That's a good thought, posterior wall, because you are finding there is some ST depression in V1 and V2, V3 also. So you may be thinking that it is posterior wall. But dear friend, first look at lead 1. Look at lead 1. There is a strong ST elevation, very strong ST elevation. Who is the friend of lead 1? AVL. Look at AVL, what that fellow is telling. He is also telling that, yeah, ST elevation is there. These are good friends. And who is the next third friend after AVL? V5, V6. Just look at V5. Yes, there is an ST elevation. J point is above. V6 also is showing mild ST elevation. So basically we can understand this particular changes, what is happening here could be related to lateral wall of the heart. So there is some lateral wall ischemia is happening. But dear friends, don't worry. Immediately you see 2-3 AVF, 2 not so great, but 3 is showing a grave ST depression here. These are called reciprocal changes. When something is happening in the lateral wall, exactly opposite changes can happen in the inferior wall also. So those things we should not be considering here. ST elevation is more standard or ST depression is more standard because 1 and AVL both are telling ST elevation. But here 2 is not telling about ST depression, but 3 is talking about. So more standard is 1 and AVL here. So this case is nothing but a lateral wall ST elevation MI, STEMI with reciprocal changes in the inferior leads. Now, please talk about this one, somebody. It is already mentioned there. Okay. Arrow marks are very, very clear for you. Somebody, please. Message in everyone's, not in private. Okay. Anybody, please. Okay, here lead 3 is showing an ST elevation. Okay, but what about lead 2? Lead 2 is silent. AVF is showing little bit changes, but V2 is again showing some mild changes. So what actually here, this is actually a Q wave infarction in the inferior wall. Now you see that here the Q wave is coming up. Now again, myocardial infarction can be divided into two types. One is Q wave infarction and non-Q wave infarction. So here, one important and interesting thing what you are noticing is there is a strong solid Q wave. When Q waves are developing in the acute infarction, as it is progressing, you know, the first change that we see in any myocardial infarction is ST elevation. ST change. I cannot say ST elevation. Sometimes it can be ST depression also. So the first change is ST changes. I should say ST changes. It can be elevated also, it can be depressed. The second thing that usually follows is T wave changes. ST elevation is followed by T wave inversion. And the third thing that should come is Q wave. If Q wave is coming up, then it is a more serious infarct. That means Q wave is not actually acute change. It will happen progressively. Probably by the second day or third day, it will start coming up. Okay. That happens only in serious cases. Q wave is not there. Then you have only one way to confirm myocardial infarction. That is through blood test. Okay. By confirming the myocardial injury markers of myocardial damage. What do you call them? They are the You have your troponin T, troponin I, troponin L, and we also have this CK, MB, creatine kinase, myocardial bound element. So those things have to be identified. So this is a good example of Q wave infarction. Yes, please. Okay, already the answer is out. So here it is anterior wall, because you know, see this V1, there is a strong ST segment elevation. V2 also strong ST segment elevation, but V3 is silent. Just see this, V3 is not having ST elevation. That means exclusively anterior wall. Anterior wall is supplied by which artery? Left anterior descending artery. It's a branch of left coronary artery. Okay, so this is about the anterior myocardial infarction. Now this one, please, the answer is not out. Lead 1, ST elevation is there, no doubt. AVL also, slight ST elevation is there, yes. But 3 and 2 not showing ST elevation. AVF is also silent. That means one thing you can be sure, inferior wall, no damage is happening. But lateral wall shows damage. Similarly, you have to go to V5 and V6. What is happening to V5? Oh, strong ST elevation is there. V6, also there is a strong ST elevation. So all four are telling the same story. Lead 1, AVL, V5, V6, all are telling the same story. So what is the problem this one? It is again lateral wall ischemia. But don't close there, dear friends. Just see this, what is happening. V1, nothing is happening. But V2, there is a ST elevation. V3, strong ST elevation. Can you see this? So huge ST elevation. It has gone almost one big box above. J point has crossed one big box above. You have to trust that. You have to trust that, because it is very loudly telling that I am also in the problem. So it is septum. When you talk about after V2, this is the septum. So septum along with the lateral wall. Very good. Somebody, Dr. Gray, has mentioned there. Lateroseptal, actually, we call it a septolateral myocardial infarction. Both ways, it's nothing but same. Yeah, it's septolateral. Okay. Now coming to this one. Yes, please. I am waiting from you. Lead 1 is silent here. He's telling that lateral wall is safe. What about AVL? AVL is showing ST depression. That's okay. That could be a reciprocal change. But what is happening here? Strongly, see this, lead 2. Another good example here. This also Q wave is there. Can you see the Q wave here? Q. This is called a pathological Q. What is the meaning of pathological Q? You know, the Q should be wider than one small box. Please write down. I think I missed it. Q, when you say Q, it should be wider than one small box, and it should be more than 1/4 of the next R wave. More than 1/4 of the next R wave. Then only it's called pathological Q. Otherwise, so many Qs will be there. But all Qs are not pathological. This pathological Q will be represented as capital Q. Yes. Q should be more than one small box in width. And in depth, no, it should be more than 1/4 of the next R wave. Then only it's pathological. So anyway, dear friends, it's a Q wave infarction. But where is the infarction? 2 is showing ST elevation. 3 is showing ST elevation. AVF is also showing ST elevation. No doubt about that. The diagnosis is already clear. The wall which is suffering is the inferior wall myocardial infarction. But before we conclude, is there any other area? Look at this, V1. What is happening to V1? What is happening to V1? Oh, there is a strong ST depression here, V1. V2 also is showing strong ST depression. Any changes in V3? Absolutely no. V4, any changes? No. V5, V6, any changes? There is a mild changes. ST elevation is there, but it's mild compared to 2-3 AVF. So here, the problem is, this is a reciprocal representation of the posterior wall. Dear friends, this is the posterior wall. Septal also? Septal, no. Because V3 and V4, very, very mild changes. Anyway, there is a global ischemia. There is a global ischemia, but very pronounced changes are seen in 2-3 AVF and V1 and V2. So this is nothing but posterior inferior myocardial infarction. Posterior inferior myocardial infarction. I am speaking about the standard representation. That means more than 4 small boxes where there is a representation, we are taking that. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. This is a case for you. 70-year-old chest pain. Please identify this. Since 12 hours, the patient is having chest pain and it is not related to exertion. 12 hours, the patient is having chest pain and it is not related to exertion. Now, where is the ST elevation? Lead 1, ST elevation is there? Yes. Lead 2, ST elevation is there? Yes.
Lead 3, yeah, mild ST elevation is there. AVF, yes, it is ST elevation. AVL also ST elevation. And AVR is ST depression. V1, no. V2, yes. V3, yes. V4, yes. V5, yes. V6, yes. What is happening here? What is happening here? Angina? Somebody said angina. Posterior lateral. Very good. Anybody? Pericardium. Excellent. This is something related to the pericardium. Three important findings here. It is a diffuse ST changes. STT changes are diffuse. And please remember, dear friends, angina is related to the exertion. Angina is related to the exertion, and here mentioned is it is not related to exertion. Ningareddy, you are perfect. You said it is concave. That's what I want you to identify the third point. The third one is here. It is concave. It is not convex ST elevation. It is concave. Please remember that. That's a good find. Another one, one more point, which you cannot see there, but I'm telling you, the point here is, if you say that there is also some types of angina without exertion, they can come up, but 12 hours, they cannot survive, dear friends. If angina continues for more than 12 hours, the patient will be in the grave. No patient can have angina for 12 hours. I will ask you one question. You can type it in the answer. What is the maximum duration myocardium can withstand ischemia? After how much time ischemia will be converted into infarction? Anybody? 12 hours? Five is hours or minutes? 3 seconds. 3 seconds is 2 minutes. 10 minutes, understandable. Yes, it is 20 minutes. Okay, 20 minutes is said to be a standard time. You should reach hospital. You know, most of the classical anginas where the patient is better by sitting. If they are better by sitting, no need to rush to the hospital, but you need to take them to the hospital. But those patients who know that you are an angina patient or ischemic heart disease patient, and if they get a pain and it is not relieved, if it is not relieved, it is continuing 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, better to run to the hospital before he collapses and die. Yeah, this is pericarditis with concave ST elevation. Yes, please. Another thing, this is the R-wave progression. R-wave progression should be like this. And I want you to see the QRS complexes, how narrow and beautiful they are. Till now, when I'm showing about the bundle branch blocks, they were very fat and obese, okay? All this QRS complex. This is actually the, okay. Please remember here, I just spoke about these things here. What is happening here? See, V3, there is a deep S wave. V1 also, there is a deep S wave. If you see here, the number of boxes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 is a 25. And here, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? 4, 5 is a 20. 25 plus 20, it is 45. That means it is more than 35. This is actually talking about left ventricular hypertrophy. In left ventricular hypertrophy, please see that S in V1, R in V5 or V6. Why they have selected V6 here? Because V5 is smaller. Anything you can select, V5 or V6. Very good. Now, please, somebody. After left ventricular hypertrophy, what will I give you? It is right ventricular hypertrophy. What is the indication here? Please see this. V1, instead of a small R, we are having a tall R. What happened to V2? Another tall R is there. V1 and V2, if you have tall R waves, remember that's a case of right ventricular hypertrophy. Yes, somebody said that RSR pattern. See here. Here we have only R and S. There is no RSR pattern. But I can say that it could be a progressive because QRS morphology looks to be normal. It is not widened. So we cannot say that this is a bundle branch block. But anyway, here you see it is coming closer. This is also coming towards. So when both are coming closer, please understand, when both are coming closer, what is this? What is this? When both are coming together, lead 1 and lead 2, here it is negative, here it is positive. When both are coming together, what is this? This is a right axis deviation. Please understand. No. It is not extreme axis. Extreme axis, both are going down. Here, a question can be asked here, whether we should consider the negative deflection or positive deflection. That means you should take a microscope and count the number of boxes here, number of boxes here. Here it appears the positive is slightly one box greater than the negative. So I have considered it positive. When both are coming together, this is the right axis deviation. And I have told you, this is not the perfect method of axis determination. When we have time, if I get an opportunity, surely I will teach you how to determine the axis. There are two methods, standard method, that is called hexaxial method and triaxial method. Using that, you will be able to exactly pinpoint the axis. That means minus 30, minus 60, or plus 105. What is the axis we can exactly determine. You need a protractor and scale. Yeah, coming to this, this is about the ventricular hypertrophies that I have already discussed. Multifocal atrial tachyarrhythmias. Multifocal atrial tachyarrhythmia. That means you see that the P waves are having different shapes altogether. I think real ECG only you can see here. This P wave you see, this P wave, this P wave, this P wave, all are having different morphology. That means here the patient is having atrial tachyarrhythmia. That's why the focus is at different level. That's why so many P waves are developing. Okay, now somebody can identify this. This is just anybody's heaven. Just by look at it. Even if you stand 1 foot away from the ECG sheet, you can diagnose this. Anybody? Multiple P waves are there. For example, if you consider this as a QRS complex, ST depression. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Dr. Devesh, you are perfectly right. This is atrial flutter. This is called C, I'm carried away by that C, what you have written. It is called seesaw pattern, that sawtooth waves. They are called sawtooth waves. Sawtooth waves are there means it is atrial flutter. Absolutely, absolutely correct. Yes, this is a flutter waves. Flutter waves are represented by which alphabet? Flutter waves are represented by which alphabet? Capital F, not small f. It is capital F. Okay, now anybody? Yes, anybody? Now you see this RR intervals are separated by multiple deflections. Each up wave is one P wave. Here, how many P waves are there? You know, more than 30, 40 P waves are there. One standard P wave is there. Rest all other small, small P waves are there. This is actually atrial fibrillation. But I have a question for you. Even if the patient is moving at the time of ECG recording, this kind of pattern will come. But how do we understand whether it's an artifact or a fibrillation? Anybody? Very good. Absolutely right, Dr. Devesh. You are perfectly right. It is irregularity. The rhythm will not be regular. You see this here. 1, 2, 3. Let us say 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. But here you see what happened. Here only two boxes are there. Immediately again it became 3. Again it became 2. It became 2. So the RR intervals matter here. Oh, you too teach ECG. Wonderful to know that. Okay. So this is the important thing here, that the RR intervals, if the RR intervals are coming with irregularity and you have a, what you call as the baseline fluctuations, that is 100% it confirms atrial fibrillation. No doubt about that. Okay. Yeah, please. I think I leave it to you. Anything that you can understand through this? Here we are talking about the I think this ECG, any abnormality? Okay. Any abnormality here? Here we are entering into a new zone of understanding. This is called PR interval. This is a WPW syndrome. Actually, you can see this here in the lead one. What is happening? In lead one, you actually see one small early deflection. You see the P wave immediately is culminating into a small wave that is called as a delta wave. The delta wave. I wanted to talk little about this WPW syndrome. There are three things in WPW syndrome. You can remember by the name itself. W refers for wide QRS complexes. As you see in the ECG, W refers for wide QRS complexes. And P refers to short PR interval. PR interval is short. And third W refers for a wave that is called a delta wave. Delta wave. WPW syndrome. And WPW syndrome, I think you know one homeopath, the one philosophy textbook is there, J.T. Kent, James Taylor Kent. That is what I used to remember, these two syndromes. James bundle and Kent's bundle. These are the two abnormal bundles. James bundle you see in case of Loewen-Gannon-Levine syndrome. James bundle is seen in case of, it's an abnormal bundle. It is seen in Loewen-Gannon-Levine syndrome. But in WPW syndrome, which bundle is in Kent's bundle? It is called Kent's bundle. So these are the two abnormal bundles, Kent's bundle and James bundle. And both these names can be joined together by James Taylor Kent. T for tachyarrhythmias. You can remember T for tachyarrhythmias. James bundle and Kent's bundle together. I should tell you. Yeah. There is a bundle called James bundle. There is another bundle called Kent's bundle. Both are abnormal bundles. James, Taylor, Kent, we remember, no? JT Kent. So James bundle and Kent's bundle, if these two bundles are present, what will happen to the patient? You know, he will develop dangerous tachyarrhythmia. So Taylor, you can remember for tachyarrhythmias. James, Taylor, Kent, James bundle, tachyarrhythmias, and Kent's bundle. Can you suggest which book, textbook? Surely, it is Goldberger's Basics of Electrocardiophysiology. That is the best book. Yeah. Coming to this ECG. Here, just observe, this is called rhythm strip. When you elaborate the lead to, this is called rhythm strip. This is called rhythm strip. This is lead to fully elaborated. Now, what do you see here? This is the P wave and this is the QRS complex. What is happening here? PR interval is prolonged. PR interval is prolonged. PR interval is prolonged. PR interval is prolonged. Continuously PR interval is prolonged, but without absence of any QRS complexes. This is called first degree heart block. You can see this is called first degree heart block. Surely I'll share the PPT with you. No problem. I will share this PPT. This is called first degree heart block. And now we will see another pattern here. In the second degree heart block, we see something here. See this PR interval slightly prolonged here. And what happened here? P wave is there. QRS complex is not there. Just see another one. This is the PR interval, slightly prolonged, little more prolonged, little more prolonged, little more prolonged. And then there is a disappearance here. So progressively, what is happening? Progressively, the PR interval is getting prolonged. Finally, there is a disappearance of QRS complex. So that is what is, dear friends, that is called Mobitz type 1. Mobitz type 1, you see PR interval gradually getting prolonged and finally there is a disappearance of a QRS complexes. Now here you see Mobitz type 2. In Mobitz type 2, what happens? Just observe in the lead 2, the best one here. Here, this is the PR interval. It looks to be shorter. PR interval, same here. And here what is happening? P wave is there, not followed by a QRS complex. PR interval standard, and there is a disappearance. PR interval standard, and there is a disappearance. This is Mobitz type 2. So Mobitz type 2 is very dangerous, and these patients need to be immediately hospitalized. If you see another one which needs immediate hospitalization is complete heart block, third degree heart block, that we will see in the next. Okay, this is called complete heart block. What is complete heart block? Another name, it is called dissociation. It is called dissociation, atrioventricular dissociation. That means atrium and ventricle both are beating separately. I ask you one question here. If atrium and ventricle are separated, there is one JVP sign we get here. When atrium and ventricle are beating separately, we get a JVP sign. What is that? Anybody? Okay, I will wait. But anyway, by the time I also teach you here, This is actually the QRS complex and this is the T wave. But you see P wave followed by QRS complex. Here you see T wave, P wave, no QRS complex nearby. After that, we are getting one. And you see this P wave is following the QRS complex. So they are beating separately, completely independently. Okay. Somebody has answered JVP increases. Yes, the JVP is, that is called Cannon A waves. In complete heart block, you get a very giant A wave that is called Cannon A waves. Cannon A waves will be seen. Okay. Yeah. We go from here. I think one more picture is there for complete. Yes, they are called Osborne waves. So another one, this is called conjoint waves. Can you see this P wave? This P wave and QRS complex are coming together. So close they are. They are so close. They are called conjoint waves. It is a case of complete heart block. Dear friends, in my life, I could identify one ECG with a complete heart block, immediately referred them, and she got one pacemaker replacement, means an artificial pacemaker. It is sometimes very, very essential because they may go into cardiac arrest very, very soon. So this presence of conjoint waves, we should be able to diagnose complete heart block. Complete heart blocks will be characterized bradycardia first. You see this, RR intervals are separated by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 300 by 8, it is less than almost 30. So the heart is going to fail very soon. And this is actually a pattern anybody can recognize. This is only no P waves here, only QRS complexes. They are coming very, very fast. This is called ventricular fibrillation. Ventricular fibrillation or ventricular flutter. The patterns will be both same. For example, if you ask me here, what I'm showing here, this is actually fibrillation. If you see here, this pattern is called flutter pattern. Flutter is both wavy. Okay. Yeah, this pattern, this is called shoulder waves. In between, you will get this one. All normal waves is there. Sometimes in between, you get this waves. This is called ventricular tachyarrhythmias. They are a good indication that this patient may go for VTs. Ventricular tachyarrhythmias into ventricular fibrillation or ventricular flutter. Yeah, this is the time where the defibrillators and all will work. Yeah, that's all, dear friends. I have resources. I'm sorry, I have taken little more time than what is given to me. Yeah, over to the organizers.
No problem, sir.
Yes.
Dr. Anupriya, are you there?
Yes, doctor.
Do we have anything left for the program?
I think, doctor, the question answer is solved in between the session.
Okay. So you can give the official vote of thanks to sir.
Yeah, it's an excellent session, sir. No doubt regarding ECG. It's a very informative and it's an awesome presentation. And all the very best for the furthermore sessions from Hope. We hope more sessions from you and for such an awesome presentation once again. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, madam. Thank you.
Yeah, welcome for the next sessions. Thank you.
So much.